this video, we're going to finish our lesson on cell damage by talking about free radical damage. Free radical damage is caused by radicals of oxygen and other chemicals, among which nitrogen. Radicals are molecules with an unpaired electron in an outermost orbital, and they are extremely reactive. Among the most common radicals in the human body, we can find hydroxyl ion, which is one oxygen molecule with an unpaired electron, the superoxide ion, which presents an extra electron delocalized on both atoms,
the hypochlorite ion,
one of the most potent radicals, which has a chloride and an oxygen with a negative charge, and which is extremely used by the immune system to destroy pathogens. Then we have the peroxynitrite, which is a peroxide with an oxygen molecule. The oxygen singlet, a very particular resonance form of an oxygen molecule, and hydrogen peroxide, which, despite not being a radical, tends to break down spontaneously into two hydroxyls in almost all physiological conditions. Radicals form in different points of the cell, mainly from the mitochondrial respiratory chain that leads to large quantities of ATP production from NADH and FADH2. The hydrogen contained in NADH and its electrons are separated at the beginning of the chain. The two electrons are passed to complex 1, while the proton is released in the mitochondrial matrix. Through complex 1, two electrons are transferred to the ubiquinone, which is a carrier, and by binding the protons in the matrix, form a complete atom. The released energy then pumps 4 protons in the intermembrane space, and this is the reaction of complex 1. The ubiquinone carries the 2 atoms of hydrogen to the 3rd complex, where an electron is yielded to cytochrome C. Another electron remains instead into complex 3. The energy release pumps 4 protons into the intermembrane space. The electron that is temporarily in the 3rd complex is passed to another ubiquinone, which, by binding only 1 electron, becomes a radical itself, semi-ubiquinone radical. However, complex 3 is normally rapidly joined by another loaded ubiquinone, which begins a new cycle that pumps out 4 protons. One electron is then passed to cytochrome C, and another to complex 3. The electron in complex 3 immediately binds the semi-ubiquinone radical, converting it into a ubiquinone capable of carrying 2 loaded hydrogen atoms. This is complex 3 reaction in 2 words. Complex 4 is loaded with electrons from cytochrome C. Electrons are then passed on to an atom of oxygen, thus creating a molecule of water and pumping out 2 protons thanks to the energy released by this phenomenon. This is complex 4 in 2 words. But we skipped complex 2, which works fairly independently. Complex 2 is an enzyme in the Krebs cycle and, using FADH2, which is produced here, it moves 2 electrons from the 2 FAD oxygen atoms to an unloaded ubiquinone, binding them to protons in the form of hydrogen. This phenomenon does not catalyze proton passage in the intermembrane space. As for the ubiquinone, it will later bind complex 3, just like we saw earlier. The summary of cellular respiration is important because it is where radical formation at complex 3 begins. When the semi-ubiquinone forms, it is a highly unstable molecule. If the flow of ubiquinone through the membrane isn't fast enough, the electron on the semi-ubiquinone radical will be given to the first available receptor, which is normally molecular oxygen located in the mitochondrial matrix. Molecular oxygen in the form of resonance becomes a superoxide anion, and this is when cellular respiration forms the radical. The flow of ubiquinone through the membrane is normally fast enough to ensure that this process is minimal, since the ubiquinone radical is immediately loaded with another electron from loaded ubiquinone that, from the previous complexes, reaches complex 3. However, in case of cellular damage, the cell produces less, reducing equivalence, and the flow of ubiquinone through the membrane is low enough to ensure the process we've just seen. Superoxide is therefore the basic form of cellular radicals, since all the others somehow derive from it. However, the superoxide radical can also be produced spontaneously by leukocytes, which, through their oxidases, form it as an offensive weapon. Superoxide is converted to peroxide by the enzymes contained in peroxisomes or by superoxide dismutase. Peroxide can also be produced by xanthine oxidase, an enzyme that deals with the disposal of waste products from the catabolism of purines, and which needs one molecule water and one molecule oxygen to produce uric acid. And in the process of hydrogen peroxide, and rarely even superoxide, can be formed. Hydrogen peroxide becomes almost spontaneously hydroxyl. This phenomenon is favored by radiation, but also by the Haber-Weiss reaction. Normally, with iron in a state of ferric oxidation, the superoxide anion can be converted into a simple molecule of oxygen with a reduction of iron to ferrous iron. But by reacting with hydrogen peroxide, ferric ion can oxidize and form two hydroxyl radicals. Simply put, what we get is the Haber-Weiss reaction, where from one molecule of superoxide and one of hydrogen peroxide, one molecule of oxygen and two hydroxyl radicals are obtained. This occurs through the reduction of iron and its consequent reoxidation. In this reaction, iron, instead of being consumed, returns to its ferric form again, and this is why this metal may cause considerable radical damage. Finally, there is peroxynitrate, which is formed by the reaction between nitric oxide, secreted in numerous processes, and superoxide anion. There are four ways to remove free radicals. The first is by spontaneous decay. Free radicals are extremely reactive species, as they are not controlled. They combine when they should not with cellular compounds. One of the most effective antiradical systems in the human body is glutathione. Glutathione is a tripeptide formed by cysteine, glycine, and glutamate. There are two forms of glutathione. The reduced form, GSH, is the commonly active one. The reduced glutathiones can react with one molecule of hydrogen peroxide and form two molecules of water. The hydrogens released by the sulfhydryl groups will bind the hydrogen peroxide molecule to form two water molecules. The two sulfhydryl groups will gather and form oxidized glutathione, or GSSG, indicating the bond between the two SH groups of cysteine. The transition from reduced to oxidized form is therefore the way glutathione eliminates the radicals. However, the oxidized glutathione must be reduced or it could not work again. This reaction is then the expanse of NADPH by an enzyme called glutathione reductase, which then reloads glutathione. Another form of anti-radical mechanism is represented by some vitamins, and especially by vitamin E and vitamin C. Vitamin E, as in the case of tocopherol, is capable of inactivating lipid radicals by transforming them into simple lipids, and while becoming a tocopherolic radical itself. At this point, vitamin C, or ascorbic acid, intervenes and loads the extra electron of the radical vitamin E, becoming radical vitamin C. Vitamin C can actually create a form of resonance as to be balanced, despite the extra electron, and cannot be considered a dangerous radical. Another system is represented by a few enzymes. First of all, peroxisomal catalase converts hydrogen peroxide into a molecule of water and oxygen. Then, superoxide dismutase converts a superoxide anion into a molecule of peroxide and a molecule of water. Superoxide dismutase contains metals that allow redox reactions. According to the type of redox reaction, there are manganese superoxide dismutase in mitochondria and copper zinc superoxide dismutase in the cytoplasm. Lastly, there is the glutathione peroxidase that, by using glutathione, catalyzes a very particular reaction. In fact, glutathione peroxidase may form an oxidized glutathione into water molecules from hydrogen peroxide in two molecules of reduced glutathione, or otherwise two water molecules and an oxidized glutathione from two hydroxyl ions into molecules of reduced glutathione. But let's have a look at the mechanisms causing free radical damage. The first one is lipid peroxidation, a type of mechanism that may occur whenever there is a specific carbon chain. It occurs, though, in a slightly different way, and in proteins and nucleases as well. In this case, a long lipid chain interacts with a hydroxyl radical that has an unpaired electron. The electron then tends to bind the hydrogen, which tends to bind the most electronegative oxygen. This results in the radical form of lipid with an unpaired electron. The unpaired electron then tends to bind the first acceptor molecule, which is usually a molecule of oxygen, leading to complex formation with lipid radical and consequent lipid peroxidation. The unpaired electron of the oxygen molecule then binds the hydrogen of another lipid, turning into lipid peroxidation. However, lipid peroxidation leaves an unpaired electron, and for this reason, the process in theory may last forever. But when will this process end? There are three possible cases leading to the end of the process. The mechanism may end if two lipid radicals interact with each other and generate a new molecule. Another option is the interaction between oxidized lipids resulting in the formation of oxygen molecule and the binding of the two oxygen atoms. Lastly, the lipid radical may be intercepted by vitamin E, becoming a radical, as we saw earlier. This would eventually result in the reconversion of the lipid radical into lipid. The effects of the chain reaction in lipid peroxidation are numerous. The first consequence is membrane disruption due to its lipid breakdown. Similarly, chain peroxidation may also occur with long carbon chains in proteins or DNA. Hence, a genetic free radical damage may lead to modifications causing neoplasia. Let's talk about the diseases related to radical formation. All diseases have a component that is linked to radical-mediated damage, but here we can see two extraordinary cases. One is erythropoietic protoporphyria, a pathology in which hemoglobin formation is impaired because of an altered portion of protoporphyrin 9. Protoporphyrin 9 normally binds iron and becomes ferritoprotoporphyrin 9, or a heme group of hemoglobin. However, in subjects with erythropoietic protoporphyria, the molecule is unstable and solar rays are enough to cause singlet oxygen formation at the terminal branches of the molecule. Singlet oxygen then causes a series of damage in cells, leaving a radical protoporphyrin. Hence, these patients cannot be exposed to the sun, otherwise the red blood cells will be destroyed by the protoporphyrin that they contain. That's why they become anemic. At the same time, they cannot eat foods, among which garlic. In the past, these patients were thought to be dead because of the hemolytic crisis happening when they were exposed to sunlight. They went, in fact, through variable stages of shock and weren't usually dead, but rather unconscious, and therefore awoke in a coffin. These three phenomena were fictionalized and used by writers to create the vampire myth, as the author of Dracula admitted. A second illness is that of glucose-6-phosphate dehydrogenase deficit. As previously stated, glutathione reductase needs NADPH to function and to restore glutathione to its active form. But where does it get NADPH from? An enzyme called glucose-6-phosphate dehydrogenase converts glucose-6-phosphate into 6-phosphogluconolactone, the first step of pentose phosphate pathway. This pathway is extremely important for producing different types of sugar, and since it is the main source of NADPH produced from this dehydrogenation. Subjects with this enzyme deficiency have therefore great difficulty activating glutathione reductase. Hence, its protection from radicals is very limited in these subjects because they cannot convert glutathione into its active form once it has reacted. For this reason, damage can be observed especially in red blood cells. These cells look like mice bites, since radical damage peroxides and breaks the membranes. In this case, liver problems and especially jaundice occur, since the hemoglobin released by the destroyed red cells is converted into bilirubin. Moreover, subjects with this pathology cannot eat certain foods that increase oxidative stress, such as fava beans and legumes in general. For this reason, this illness is called favism.
Thank you for watching. This video was created by School of Biomedical Sciences Agora. We hope you enjoyed it. If you're curious or have any doubt or question, please feel free to leave a comment below. If you want to find out more about us or want to support our project, click on the following link to visit our website.